You have a beautiful garden. You take care of it yourself?
What?
You take care of the garden yourself?
Oh, yes. Yes, so far I have done it all myself.
Is it a lot of work?
No, it's fun. I say God takes care of the garden, but the devil takes care of the lawn. Don't you think so?
Yeah. But how do you do in winter? Because the winters are tough.
Crochet, and make rugs, braid rugs.
That's how you keep yourself busy?
Oh yes, keeps me very busy, and cook 3 meals a day.
What are you doing now?
What am I doing now? I'm trying to weed my carrots, and I'm going to cultivate the potatoes and radishes over there, and onions, carrots, and I have a lot of onions. Everything needs weeding. It's all weedy. And the flowers, I can't work in there now because they're high, and I'd break them all off.
I see. Do you have a a big family, or are you alone?
I have Otto Walters living upstairs. He rooms with me. Yeah, that's my interest, raising vegetables and flowers. It's a lot of fun. I like it much better than going out and gossiping.
Do you like it, living in Glencoe?
Oh, very much. I wouldn't. My sisters wanted me to come to the cities, but I would not go to the cities.
No? Why?
Well, it's so nice out here, seeing all these flowers grow. I love that. You know, I don't care much for the city.
I understand you very well. When you have such a beautiful garden.
That's what...
Dear old Miss Lützow, without you and your beautiful garden, we might have missed Glencoe altogether. Of course, that day, there was also the town fair.
Korea.
We also have members of World War I.
What about you?
Vietnam. Vietnam was bad to begin with. It was, you didn't have the populace was not for it. So therefore, they didn't get the respect that was due them. I mean, they died That's just right. as easy You're as right. anybody else did. They bled just as red of blood. So we try to promote for God and country. Okay? That's what it's all about. We've all been in the Armed Forces. We all know what it's all about. And hopefully, some of our younger generation will take hints from what we're doing. The high schools or grade schools around the community, we donate the flags to them, and we promote promotionalism. Americanism, I'm sorry.
What is that
around the community? Oh, we have with us
That's
some...
That's French. You ought to know what that is.
We have some we have with us some royalty that was formed in your country. You better explain.
That's the commander. The chef de garde.
G-57. Under G-57. B-9. Under B-9. 72. Roll 72. Here's a bingo. Hang on to your cards. Okay. Georgette. It's a good bingo. Anybody else? Okay. B2.
I'm grew up in the metropolitan area with the hustle and bustle, and I'd never go back.
Why wouldn't you go back?
Everything is slower out here. You know people. You can look across in a celebration like this, and you can see people that you know. You look at guys like...
What's your occupation?
I don't know if I want to say.
Say, go on.
Okay. I'm the assistant chief of police in this community. But we loosen up and we're human too, right? Okay. Okay. You know I love you so.
It was a Saturday of June a few years ago. Here I was in Glencoe having a good time with the town folks. For days we traveled around Minnesota, filming school graduations, shopping malls, Indians, miners, factories. It felt good to be on the road again, camera in hand, making friends. Who are you? What channel is it for? They always ask. We're French, and this is a documentary for public television. Oh, well, we're all Germans here. Welcome to Glencoe, Minnesota. So, we settle down at the Star Motel. A very quiet Sunday morning. Glencoe is a small farming community, 60 miles west of Minneapolis, with 5,000 inhabitants and a few industries. There are 9 churches in town, 7 Protestant, 2 Catholic. No synagogue. Reverend Chapman, head of the First Congregational Church of Glencoe, is an amiable gentleman, very open-minded.
We do it the way we did it. You know, change comes slowly in an area like ours. People like to do it the way their parents did it and the way their grandparents did it. And yet there's the tension of the youth group or the youth culture wanting to change things, too. And I don't know how the balance works out, but that's there. I think that's also part of modern life. The divorce rate in our country's up.
And here?
Yeah, it's up here, too. And I think that's really a recognition of the fact that many marriages 20 years ago were in trouble, but they stayed together. And 50 years ago, a divorce was almost unheard of. But the problems within the home and the marriage were still there. You know, I think divorce is a recognition of the fact, at least one part of it is that it's a recognition of the fact that there are some marriages that end in failure, and they don't hold them together anymore artificially.
Seen by an outsider, the Glencoeites are a quiet, somewhat placid, extremely friendly group of people. But they have one devastating passion, lawn mowing. At all hours, men, women, children chop furiously every bit of grass that sticks out. Maybe a vestige of the pioneer spirit.
How many times a week do you mow the lawn?
Well, it's once a week for sure. Once a week, we get rain like we had now in the last few days. It's once a week, and if we get more rain, we can expect that we'll have to do it probably twice a week.
Why is that?
Because the grass will grow that fast. the lawn and your property would start looking pretty shoddy if you didn't keep the grass cut. If you move around town, there's a few places where you can see that. So I've got a daughter at home, and she's just home from college, and she hasn't gotten into the routine yet.
You like doing it?
Oh, it's okay. Nothing else to do, so I just do this.
Is this the worst part of the job?
Not really. I like this better than pushing and mowing, you know.
Are you in school?
No, we just got out about a month ago.
So what are you going to do now?
Oh, I might get a job at a high school or something, you know, find some job to do. Anything.
On the outskirts of town, a battle is raging between the local softball team and their arch rivals, the Valkyries of Hamburg, Minnesota.
Nice pitch. All right, one more now, one more.
I will not get into an argument with those girls.
Okay, Paula, let's take this one now. You got a big range, she's tall.
Ah! Male!
Good cut, good cut. Way to go, Roberta. You're ready. Got one now. Okay, now. Pick your feet there. He's gonna go. Woo! Way to go, Paula. Bring her in now.
Come on, Jelaine, just a little one. Come on, we gotta go now. Get things right in.
Go down, Pat!
Happy you won?
Yes.
Oh, I said that.
Happy. Oh,
so am I.
I'm very happy. It's only the second game we won.
Second game we won all year.
Do you normally win?
No.
Yeah, we won.
We never win.
We always win.
Oh, we always.
Where are we going?
Pizza Ranch.
We tried hard.
Is it we did. We worked for the win.
No. This is just league play. We have
we won't get
six more
far.
Games to go. And then we play tournaments.
Where's our boss?
The town Dairy Queen is one of the few gastronomic resources of Glencoe. We eat here twice a day.
All your family works here?
Quite a few, yeah. Three, yes, my wife, myself, and a daughter and a son. And an older daughter helping out, yeah.
Well, there's five of you.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Good, thank you.
And it's doing well.
Yeah, can't complain. Real good business. I sold beer for 23 years. I like this better.
You're Mr. Barnum.
I'm Mr. Barnum, Jr. And Mr. Barnum, Sr. is back there.
And you have no connection with the circus family?
Not that we know of.
So how do you
expect? We were here before the P.T. Barnum. It is done on the circus theme, yes. The medicine wagon, I don't know if that's going to give you a good shot of that up on top there.
Uh-huh.
Distributor
that's
cures.
The
prescriptions are filled, yes. That's your prescription drugs. And the patent medicines are all along this aisle over here. I better keep my finger out of here. We have our gift section in the back and cards.
Charizel shop.
Your horse may be of interest up above there. This is Mrs. Barnum Jr. over here. She's doing inventory for an order. She does a lot of the gift buying and that, practically all of it.
Hello.
Hi. What part of France are you from?
Paris.
Paris?
Uh-huh. Every Frenchman will tell you he comes from Paris.
Oh, I suppose.
My granddad settled there in 69. 1869, and my grandma settled in 1854 when she was 2 years old.
The population of Glencoe is remarkably homogeneous, 80% of German origin. A few miles north, Silver Lake is almost entirely Polish.
They come from Germany, Hanover, that's Lower Saxon.
And there were Indians around?
Oh yeah, they lived, say 10 years with the Indians. They come there every fall to hunt. And
did they get along well?
Oh yeah, they were really friendly. Yeah, they were friendly.
And what happened with the Indians after?
Well, when the Indian outbreak was in 62, I think. And then the Indian War started here. And, ever since then, there were no Indians around here.
This is our friend Rod Petticord, the assistant chief of police.
They have a silent alarm on here, and it went off. So it was a false alarm, but nevertheless, we check them out.
Could we get mugged in Glencoe?
No, we don't have many major crimes in this community, and that's the way we like to keep it.
Rod was a little loose yesterday at the fair. Today he's all business.
We're only a six-man department, but we have about 14 reserve officers. And needless to say, in a small community with six men, they don't go very far. So the reserve rides along, they ride along free. They just donate their time, and they help us out in whatever way they can. Real good bunch of guys. In fact, I didn't say guys, we've got a couple women on the reserve also. So.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. It's good PR, too, to show the public that we're not too chauvinistic, that we can have women work with us, too. Of course, the one reserve is my wife, and she also works for the sheriff's department, so there's no problem there at all.
Roth's favorite topic is drug abuse.
I came out here in 1971, and a lot of the drug use would be alcohol and the diet pills at that time. And of course they take a few diet pills and load up a little bit on the beer, they got pretty snaky. Then the trend kind of switched over to the marijuana, and it pretty much stayed with that. Then it switched now where it's the booze and the marijuana. And that's the reason that display was made up. I carry it with me to the schools. I'm originally from Minneapolis, St. Paul. And I've got nieces and nephews up there, and you've got kids that are 8, 9, 10 years old that are smoking dope. You don't see it out here. You know, if you'd find somebody that age doing it, it would be just a long shot, we'll say, because the kids aren't doing it. You might find an 8, 9-year-old that might be drinking a beer, but he don't go out and get drunk or get high on a regular basis. It's just unheard of.
How many
health
calls?
280 horsepower.
And what does it make for, basically?
For working up the fields, like in the spring and fall, for doing all the tillage work, you can say. It doesn't do any of the planting or anything.
It's one of the biggest I've seen.
It's the biggest that John Deere, this brand name, makes.
Brian Fullman is 10 years old. He doesn't drink beer, but he drives a big toy. Just outside Glencoe, his father runs Fullman Seeds, a 2,000-acre operation that doesn't fit my European notion of a farm.
Farmers' machinery has always gotten bigger. Consequently, they have to buy more land in order to use that farm machinery efficiently. Well, for instance, our federal land bank will not make a loan to a farmer who has only 80 acres because they know that he cannot raise a family on 80 acres and still pay off the mortgage. And so there are very few 80-acre farms, whereas back in the 50s, that was the average size farm in this community. And now, as I say, there are very few of them, but the farms have gotten larger and larger and fewer farmers as a result.
Since 76, we had the opportunity to buy several farms that were within a 2-mile radius of where we're standing. Because of our location here in this part of Minnesota, we're within 40 miles of the river points near Minneapolis and St. Paul. Therefore, that is where most of the grain in this particular area goes. And of course, most of the grain that goes to the river points therefore goes down to the Gulf of Mexico and gets shipped to other countries throughout the world. We live as good as a businessman in town because of the size of the operation. For the amount of risk we're taking, we're probably not as well paid as what we'd like to be. The risk is quite high because of the variability of weather and prices, but we're comfortable with what we're doing.
This is the Security State Bank of Glencoe, Minnesota. It's a privately independent bank owned by local individuals right in the town here.
Who started this bank?
My father did. In 1935.
So you're at the same time a banker and a farmer.
Right. So the people can't fool us when it comes to agriculture loans.
What are you doing exactly at the bank? What's your job?
I'm a cashier and I'm a ag and loan officer.
Clayton Husser has 5 sons. One of them, Gail, works at the bank. But after hours, back at the farm, he's got some homework to do. Clayton's eldest son runs a neighboring farm. He was a champion wrestler in high school.
It's running about 50% moisture.
We got a lot of rain this weekend. No?
You're right, a lot of rain.
I should be chopping by the neighbors, but we've got so much water standing in the field, it
gets stuck.
Could mud up the hay field, so I could come over here and work today.
Clayton's wife also splits her time between the farm and her job in town.
Then when the boys got old enough, they became involved in 4-H and they decided they liked farming also. So we started in with the dairy cattle, and now last year I think David started in with the hog operation.
This is my son David. These are the fellows from France, and they want to look at this operation here.
Are you working at the farm full time?
Yeah. Take care of the pigs part of it, mostly. Take care of the calves too, other than that.
And are you still a student or?
No, I graduated 2 years ago from high school, Blanco here.
And you're not interested in banking?
Not really. I like what I'm doing right now, so it doesn't bother me that I'd be working there or anything. I just like this, so that's what I do. That's what I do best, so that's what I'm gonna do.
But you graduated in agriculture or took a degree in farming?
No. I got a degree in hard knocks, and that's it. I learned from the experiences I had. That's all I do. You learn a lot. In pigs, you learn a lot every day. It's a new experience every day of what goes on. They're sort of a weird breed of animals. And it's not... You got some hard days in the winter and stuff, but otherwise, it's not a bad occupation at all.
David's pigs will appear eventually on your breakfast table. They end up their short lives at the Hormel plant in Austin, Minnesota, 100 miles from Glencoe.
Ever since I was, old enough to think, you could just farming. That's all I ever wanted to do. I'm my own boss. I don't have to go and punch a time clock, and have somebody get mad at me and stuff like that. I get up in the morning, I know what I got to do. I'm my boss. If I don't want to do too much this on a certain day, I don't. If I don't feel like it. But usually you got to keep on working.
It's a lot of work,
Oh, yeah, but you get it back in the long run. Just like when the crops look good, you makes you feel good when the crops look good and stuff like that.
You make a good living?
Fair, manage. It's not like some people would like to have it, but it's a living. You gotta give up things to have your peace of mind, I guess.
Jim McIntyre, at 28, is the youngest farmer we've met so far. He runs a middle-sized farm that belonged to his grandfather. His father lives next door, and they're business partners.
And you don't see very many young farmers either like me. I only know three of them right around the area right here, and that's like about a 20-mile radius. So there's a lot of them that light the farm when it gets started, but they just haven't got the capital. The bank won't give them the money they want because it just takes too much.
So you think of yourself as being lucky in a way?
Yeah, I think so. Very lucky.
So this is your house? Could you show me around?
This is the kitchen right here. This is our kitchen table where we eat all our meals.
Hello.
Hi.
This is a dining room, which really doesn't get used for much besides when you have a lot of company, then the company will come and sit in here, friends and neighbors or whatever.
Do you often entertain neighbors or?
Well, birthdays, whenever there's a birthday around, and one of the kids' birthdays, will have a little birthday party.
And this is zero.
This is what's called a living room in here. So we watch our TV, if there's any TV to watch, or just to sit and read the paper. We got a couple hours to read the paper at night.
Do you watch a lot of TV or?
Just in the winter. In the summer I don't watch much at all. I haven't got much time for that. I'm too busy. In the winter there's more slack, more free time. There's no field work or anything like that, just the chores, taking care of the pigs and cattle.
How many children do you have?
We have three. Mm-hmm. One's gonna be 5, and one's a year and a half, and one's gonna be 5 months.
Are you going to make farmers out of them?
I hope.
Hope so.
I hope somebody plans on staying.
Yeah, probably not the girl.
And you married very young.
Yeah.
I was 18.
18 and a half.
18 and a half.
Is that young to get married here? Or?
Not for a woman. For a
it
girl.
Is now. Back 7 years ago, it was. But now you find out more girls are waiting till they're 20, 21, 22, even older than that. Save your money, because everything's so expensive.
Yeah, they want to work first.
Yeah, they'd like to work first so they can buy nice things for the house.
But you decided immediately to get married, or?
We waited about a year and a half. We were going together, and then we married after that.
6 months after I gave her engagement ring, and we got married 6 months after. And 2 years after.
It was just the right one, so I just.
And 2 years after that, then a little girl was born. One day after our wedding anniversary.
Jim and Bev's hospitality is so gracious, I feel I've known them all my life. We're back the next morning. Jim is riding his tractor.
Jobs on the farm right now, I'd say. Gives you time to think. Gotta do a lot of that nowadays.
Meanwhile, Bev prepares lunch. It means opening tin cans. The McIntyre don't even drink their own milk.
You think of yourself more like as a housewife or?
I don't want to be thought of as a housewife.
But you help a lot at the farm, no?
Yeah, I'd rather be thought of that way as like a homemaker and partner with Jim, put it that way. I like helping outside. I like helping a lot outside. I'm driving tractor and things like that.
Did you do it when you were younger?
Mm-hmm. I did a lot when I was younger.
Did you think of any other life, any other thing that you would like to do?
I suppose every girl wants, you know, has different things she'd like to do with her life. I sometimes dreamed of being an airline hostess. But after I met Jim, that all, I forgot about it.
Us again.
Can our Jesus be our guest at these gifts so as we bless them?
It's hot.
How do you explain there's no blacks in this community? Practically not one, I would say.
Well, I don't know. It's hard to say. It's people just seem to not really get along with blacks around here. It's, of course, there never really was any blacks that really came here. One or two, and then they just kept on going. I know, like Hutchinson over there, northwest here, 20 miles, they have a few blacks over there. But it's just no place for blacks around here, I guess. Just don't like it.
You mean people don't like them, or they don't like staying here?
Well, I suppose it's a little of both, I think. The people are very prejudiced against blacks out here. It's hard to say why. Although you talk to anybody that was in the service, and you don't find too many servicemen that care about blacks. I don't know.
So you could have gone to Vietnam. You were the right age.
Yeah, just that my draft number was a bit higher than what they drafted that year. I know my brother, his number was quite low, and he managed to get a draftee from it because I was still in school. And as long as he was the only son at home, they couldn't take him. But they could have taken him, but my dad worked at it to get a farm deferment for him. So and that was right in 68 when my brother could have got drafted. That was just at about the peak of the war out there. Or what do they call that, scrimmage? It wasn't a war. That's what they call it. It's kind of funny. Enough men died and it wasn't a war.
Vietnam was coming back more than once in our Glencoe conversations. There was something else. An unsung hero of the entire war movement of the 60s was from Glencoe.
You mean Brad Medici?
Yes.
That's my son.
And
that you're talking about, the Minnesota 8.
Yes.
Yes.
What happened to him? He was on trial?
Yeah, they had a trial in federal district court in Minneapolis, and he was sentenced to prison for several years.
What's happened to him?
He's in California now. Yeah. He has a band out there.
Oh, yes? He's playing music?
Oh, yeah, he's a good musician. Very good.
Brad grew up in a conservative, pretty conservative middle-class background. There.
I asked Millie Benicke what exactly were the charges against her son.
Oh dear, I wish you hadn't asked me that. So I think it was burglarizing with the technical wording, but with intent to destroy public property. But I don't know what the technical name would be.
But actually, the action was to burn the draft cards.
Right. They had, there were actually four different groups who entered different draft offices simultaneously with the intent of destroying the draft records. They weren't successful. I think only in one place were they successful, and those young men were not caught, but Brad was one of the unfortunate ones.
And did you know about it when he did it?
Or? No, no, absolutely not. And it was a great shock because we've always been very law-abiding people, and with Arnold being a lawyer, I think we were probably more conscious of obeying the law than a lot of families. I think maybe from a selfish point of view to begin with, I was distressed. But as time went on and I could see how important it was to him and how important it was that we understand what he was doing, I became more supportive of him. As I say, Arnold was supportive right almost from the beginning, not supportive of breaking the law, but supportive of doing whatever he could, you know, to end the war.
Talk about a fraud on the young men of America. That was it, I'll tell you. And I couldn't blame these young men for protesting. Even though I spent all the years in the war that I did. And I believed in that war, you know? It was right, but there was so much wrong in this that I hope this country never has to go through this again, I'll tell you. It was pretty well torn apart.
I was very supportive of Mr. Nixon, his first term, and when I was Republican chairwoman, and Mr. Nixon was up for election in the second term, I'm probably one of the few Republicans in the state who voted for Mr. McGovern. Now I'm just involved with city politics, just on the city council.
But Millie's new interest is not politics. It is show business.
Something I've wanted to do all my life, and I've just found time to do it. Had 5 children, and they're all gone from home now. And something I've always wanted to do, and I decided to do my own thing, and this is the result. I've written 2 plays.
How would you define your play, Much Ado About Corn?
I don't know, but it was really corny.
It is my pleasure, duty, to announce the arrival of the Count, oh la la, Otto von Contemptuous.
I've come to evict you. The mortgage on your corn kingdom is due today. No. You haven't paid. Out you go, off my land. Zounds, it'll be mine. All mine! I'll be king villain!
You know, Corny, we could trick them, poison them, give them some of Granny's corn liquor.
We must prevail, Earthy dear. We're the only royal kingdom left in this vast country, and we're surrounded by people, individual people, farmers they're called. They own
Meet
all
Steve,
the land around
leading man of the Buffalo Creek Players, one of Glencoe's most eligible bachelors, who inseminates cows for a living.
Okay, this is bull sperm. It's color dyed green to signify that it's Holstein. Okay, I have to, in order to ensure the best sperm quality, I have to get it into the cow as soon as I can. Okay. I'm inserting my hand into the anus so I can, right beneath my hand is the cervix. And my destination is to thread the pipette through the cervix and then deposit the semen into each horn of the uterus. Okay, that's what you get for your money right there. So, now.
In about 2 hours, she'll release an egg, and hopefully the sperm will unite with the egg, and then we'll have conception. And then the gestation is 9 months. My company has their bulls in DeForest, Wisconsin. The semen is processed and frozen there, and I pick up monthly shipments. It is frozen and stored in liquid nitrogen. The sperm life is indefinite. They started in 1953. They have used ampules from that time period and have still settled cows, and that's a period of 26 years. Some of these cows produce 80 or 90 pounds of milk per day. They run into problems if their udder does not stay up where it belongs. They generally let them have about 2 months rest period before they come in with their next calf, because there's a lot of strain put on them when they're producing this much milk. This is a heavily cow populated area, so I can make a good living within that area.
Steve inseminates about 5,000 cows a year. He loves his job, but he also enjoys the single's life.
And you're still a bachelor. Could you tell us why?
Well, when I had the money, I didn't have the time. When I had the time, I didn't have the money. I enjoy the lifestyle. I enjoy the independence of being a bachelor. I live my life. I do. My job comes first, but when that's done, I have to keep my mind clear. I have to do other things too. I could put 20 hours a day into my job if I wanted to, but my mind would not be able to handle it.
But do you eventually consider getting married and having children at some point, or is it?
My target date is 35 years, when I'm 35, so I've got 4 years to go yet to find the right one.
Would it be possible for you to have a relationship with a girl here without being married?
I've done it several times. It's no problem.
No problem at all?
Not to me. I don't let it bother me, no. I'm sure some people would get a little uptight about it. I'm sure some people would think people were spying on them. Doesn't make any difference to me.
But would you say, is divorce completely accepted?
But that varies from person to person. Some of the older people accept it as the way things are. Some look at their own marriage and they've made their marriage work for 30 years. They wonder why the kids aren't able to. But I think a lot of people realize that the times are changing and pressures are different. Economic pressure situations are much different than they were even 10 years ago.
But it's still a very religious community, you know?
Yes, there are factions that are quite religious. I'm not affiliated with any church at this time, and I haven't been for a while. It's just my lifestyle. That's my own choice.
Have there been any situation where people had to cope with the public opinion or anything like that?
Well, there are factions that don't think much of the theater group because they think we're too progressive, that we're trying to do too much too fast. But anytime, I don't care where you are, if you try to be progressive, there are people that are trying to keep things at a status quo. That's just the human nature. What impresses me a lot about this town, people don't try to make you think their way. I mean, they'll allow you to think your way. They might not agree with it, but they'll allow you to do it, which I think is very good.
Have you been working here long?
About 3 weeks.
What made you decide to be a gas station attendant?
I'm sick of being a waitress.
Have you considered not getting married, or is it?
Yeah. Up to about a year ago, I decided I wasn't going to get married, but I decided this year it's a very good idea.
Why?
Tired of being alone.
Gene, a Social Security employee at the county seat, is a member of the theater group.
What are you doing?
I am writing a note to our accountant.
What's in the note?
Well, I have to tell her to hold a payment on someone because it's in a halfway house up in Candio High County because the other county issued the payment for us. And I just found out about it today. So we have to reimburse the other county directly. So, this way.
Small. Kitchen?
Kitchen? This is my bedroom. It's a mess, as you can tell. I have too much stuff, no place to put it.
Okay.
My roommate's name is Grace. This is her room. Here. The living room.
Do you spend much time here?
No. I'm gone most of the time. I work two jobs, and then with the theater, I'm not home very much at all. Job number two, for extra money, is bartending on weekends. I usually work every Friday and Saturday night at a little municipal liquor store that's between Glencoe and Hutchinson. There are good things and bad things about it. You see a lot of I get tired of seeing the people that have drinking problems that come in there. They drink too much.
It seems to be a natural in this area.
I think it's boredom. I think people don't have anything better to do with their time. And it starts at a very early age. When I was in high school, that was, it was illegal, so that was what was exciting about it. You'd go out and drink.
Including women?
Sure.
Jean is a free spirit. She'd mentioned previously having renounced her Catholic faith.
Do you really want to know?
Curious.
Well, the hypocrisy within the church, and just from a personal experience. When I first moved away from home when I was 18, I moved in with a boyfriend. And probably was not a very wise thing to do. I wasn't ready for it. And I lived with him for 3 months, and the whole thing fell apart, and I moved back to Hutchinson, and I discovered that I was pregnant. Well, I didn't have a whole lot of choices at that time. Abortion wasn't legal. I didn't even know that there was such a thing as an abortion. I don't think at that time I could have, my conscience would have let me have gone through with something like that. But I knew that I was too young to care for a child. I felt I was too much of a child myself. And it wouldn't be fair, so I decided to give the child up for adoption. Well, here I was in Hutchinson. I had no place to go. I didn't have a boyfriend anymore, and I was pregnant, and I had to tell my parents. It was inevitable, and of course they were upset. And the first thing my mother said was, "You've got to talk to a priest. You know, this is awful." The priest called my mother in, and he laid this big guilt trip on her. He told her it was all her fault that this had happened to her daughters, and it was because we wore our skirts too short, and which is the only time we wore dresses is when we went to church. So, and he made her feel terrible, like she was entirely to blame, and there was no. I know it's not fair to judge a whole church on the basis of one individual, but there was just. I don't know, there was just no humanity there. I feel that that's really lacking in the church. I think that there's too much emphasis on the doctrine and the rules and the, the black and white sorts of things and just not enough caring.
And tell me, so what did you do with the child?
I gave it up for adoption.
Are you sorry about that?
No.
Do you intend to get married at some point?
I don't really care if I do or not. I think it would be nice. At some time it would be nice to have a family.
I guess I feel secure enough in myself that if I would never get married, that it wouldn't ruin my life, or I wouldn't consider myself a failure. If I ever do get married, I'd like to feel that I was marrying for love, not out of necessity or not just because it's something that I ought to do. But I enjoy men. I enjoy meeting men. And so I guess I have a lot of short-term relationships or just friendships. And that's sufficient for me. I know women, though, that are very single women who are very frustrated just living here because they would like to find the right person, settle down in the area. And the availability of single men is just limited. It depends on the age group, too. Like, I'm 26, I'll be 27 this month. So I'm getting up there as far as age, as far as being, I'm not considered young anymore in this area. Young is maybe 21, 22.
What happens if you're gay in Glencoe?
You don't tell anyone. you probably don't make a pass at anyone. I think you'd probably have to carry out your private life in Minneapolis or someplace if you were going to live in a small town. It's not, it wouldn't be accepted. I mean, that's one area that there's a lot of prejudice against. It's a lot of jokes made about homosexuality. People don't want to talk about it. So it'd be very difficult for someone to live, a gay person to live openly here.
Do you find men very macho here?
Yeah. I think so. I think most of the men I meet, it depends. I mean, there are some like professional men, you know, that have been in different areas and they've come back here and they're a little more open, you know, and they can carry on a friendship with a woman or just accept her at an equal level. But most of the men around here are into dominance. They have a hard time relating to me because they never have a serious conversation with a woman. The only thing they can comment on is, you know, how you look, or the sexual thing. It gets to be hard to put up with.
I suppose so.
Yeah.
Is sex very important for you?
I don't know how to answer that. Yeah, I guess it's important. It's something that I end up shutting off, you know. I put in the back of my head. I get busy with all these other things, and so I don't have to think about it. But I don't know. If I meet somebody that I really like, I guess I don't have any hesitation. If I want to sleep with that person, I will. But there's a lot more involved, I think, in that than just, I don't know. I don't go out and look for sex just because I'm horny. That's not what turns me on. But if I don't know, if I meet someone I like, I can't even talk about this. I'm sorry. I haven't thought about it that much. I guess it's important, isn't it, to everyone?
Are you part of the hospital, sir?
What?
Are you with the hospital?
No, with the Glen Haven over there.
You just walking around, or?
I'm taking my exercise. I lived there at Glen Haven for 3.5 years.
You're retired now, of course.
Retired?
Yeah.
I wouldn't call that retired, being in there. Glen Haven, that's where all the people go to other place to go.
You don't like it?
No, I'm tired of it.
And how did you get there?
Well, I didn't no place to home no more. My wife died. And the boys are all working for themselves.
Where would you like to be?
In the graveyard.
Well, you have plenty of time for that.
You don't know what a fellow always got to go through when you're healthy.
Did they take good care of you?
Oh, yes. Yeah, they do.
We take care of residents that need 24-hour nursing care. We provide many aspects to that care, not only nursing care, but also social activities. We have an activities department that the residents that are capable or able spend time there doing various crafts. That is the main purpose of Glen Haven, is to serving the elderly and those that need 24-hour care.
Strawberries this month, that's what we're waiting for. It takes 2.5 gallons of crushed strawberries for the birthday party. So I think that's going to be really great.
For each birthday party?
For this birthday party for June. The Congregational Church from Glencoe is serving it.
Each
and
church does a little bit different.
This time, and so we're waiting for strawberries.
Great talk from our presidential hopeful, Howard Baker. All this and more on 2020 tonight on ABC.
Mom, I need a gel for fresh breath.
Relax. We'll get fluoride and fresh breath with AquaFresh.
Introducing new double protection AquaFresh. All the cavity-fighting fluoride of the leading paste and all the breath freshener of the leading gel. Concentrated in one toothpaste. New double protection AquaFresh fights cavities and freshens breath.
It is not easy for Pedro to a favorite Mexican snack. Does not come from Mexico.
Mexico.
Tostitos brand, crispy round tortilla chips.
Mexico.
They have an authentic tortilla taste.
Mexico.
At the Emmanuel Lutheran Church of New Auburn, a few miles from Glencoe, Tammy and Robert are getting married this morning. Tammy is 17.
Robert Mark Schwanke and Tammy Jean Schutting have consented together in holy wedlock and have declared the same before God and in the presence of this company. I pronounce them husband and wife.
We've only just begun to live.
Okay.
Best wishes, Tammy. You're just beautiful.
Thank you.
After the ceremony, a banquet takes place at Play Manor, a vast ballroom Glencoe is most proud of. Family and neighbors, the almost 300, eating and drinking heartily.
I'll get married.
After the meal, bride, groom, bridesmaids, and ushers spend the rest of the afternoon bar hopping.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good rock, girl.
Do our thing, shall we say.
We enjoy just doing what we happen to feel, because every band gives us something just a little bit different. And every band will play a little bit different in the modern and their polkas and so on and so forth. And we respond to the music that they happen to be playing.
I am nervous driving into Glencoe. 6 years have passed. It is a long time in America. This garden. Isn't it Miss Litzau, right where we left her?
Miss Litzau, it is such a great pleasure to see you.
Is that, yeah.
How it's have nice. You been?
What?
How have you been all these
oh,
years?
Just wonderful. Just wonderful.
How old are you now?
91.
Still going strong, huh?
I should say.
And you still...
I don't care to have anybody help me.
You still...
But I don't get done, just... It don't run away.
You still taking care of it all by yourself?
Everything by myself. Household, I can. I canned pickles, and so far I haven't canned tomatoes yet. They are quite ripe enough. But they're coming.
Well, well, maybe nothing has changed after all.
See you again.
Long time no see, yeah? Sir, you're still in the same office?
Same office.
Still working?
Every day.
My first visit is with Arnold Benecke, the town lawyer. His wife, Millie, has written 5 new plays. To answer the challenge, Arnold has taken up acting.
Her house, she lived about 300 miles away.
Hi, Rod.
Hi.
Nice to see you again. How much time do you spend in this car?
Well, last night I spent about 9 hours in it.
Glencoe has lost Rod Petticourt. He's now deputy sheriff of the neighboring county. He has put on weight. He misses Glencoe.
You get almost as high as the trailer.
Remember Tammy and Robert Schwanke? We married them 6 years ago. A spacious 6-room trailer. 2 children, 2 steady jobs. In a happy family, there's never a plot.
Steve, we come back a few years later and we find you still busy.
Yes, I'm still enjoying the job. This is probably about the 50 or 60th thousandth cow I've inseminated in my career. So, starting to get the hang of it finally.
And last time we talked to you, you were thinking of possibly getting married. What's happened of your plan?
I'm still thinking about it. I'm on a 5-year plan. I made it by 35, and now we're looking at 40. Then we'll think about it again. So, the opportunity hasn't knocked yet, I guess.
You're too busy with your cow. I want to ask you, do you develop a personal relationship with the cow?
Not on a one-to-one basis, no, there's too many. I inseminate about 7,000 a year, so it's a little bit difficult to get on a one-to-one relationship with them. But well, I'm on a one-to-one relationship with their owners. It's part of the business. There are always a few cows that stand out in your mind for one reason or another, if they're ornery or whatever. But as far as...
What about your swinging life?
My swinging life? getting a little older, it doesn't swing quite as quickly as it used to, but I still try to participate when I can. Play a lot of softball in the summer.
Glencoe farmers are having their best crop in 2 decades. They think it's a disaster. We're back to Jim and Bev McIntyre, the young farmers I liked so much.
Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. Let this food to us be blessed. Amen.
Apparently, nothing has changed. Oh, yes, Bev works at the post office. And Jim worries.
A year ago, 100 pounds of milk was $13.20, and today it's only $11.60, so it's dropped close to $2, 100 weight in a year. And you got to make it up, so what you do is you milk more cows, and by doing that, you create a problem by putting more milk on the market, which the price is going to go down some more yet, but you're a farmer, dairy farmer, is forced to do that, and there's just no place to put the milk anymore. That's why the price is going to keep on coming down until enough of us go out of business so there's less cattle.
But let me ask you, do you want your children to go into farming?
When I, 10 years ago, or 7 years when my first boy was born, yes. But now, I'm kind of hoping he can find something else that he's interested in to do instead of farming, because I don't see no future in it no more. It's sad to me, because I like to farm, but I'm wondering if I'm going to be here 10 years from now. Am I going to be farming 10 years from now? I don't know. There's a lot of people probably won't, and it's just a matter of elimination. Who's going to come next? Who's going to...
That's one of the reasons I took the job, is because putting the money in a bank, and when the kids get college age, if they want to go to college, I want to give them that option. I would love to see all three of my kids go to college, and then if the boys do want to farm, or if Lori marries someone that would like to farm and the boys don't want to, at least they have that college education to fall back on. Yeah, I want them to have something besides farming.
It's sad. I don't know if you could realize what it feels like to live on the farm and to love the land. It's like loving your kids or your wife, you know, to love the land. It's a different feeling inside of you. Maybe you don't know what I'm talking about, but it's just a feeling. It just grabs you right inside, right in the middle of you.
I went through a feeling of guilt where, what did I do wrong? Should I have made changes earlier? Should I have tried different things? Yet we're traditionalists. It's hard to change. You've done things certain way. Just like planting in spring and harvesting in fall, it's...
Terry Wagner we'd not met before. He almost went under last spring. His future is cloudy.
We're in a transition period, perhaps.
But still, do you think a lot of people sort of...
Oh, yes,
blame
very
it
much
on...
so, very much so. You see lots of depression and guilt and amongst farmers. I guess you can compare it to... dying or someone telling you have a terminal illness. First you are angry, and then no, why me? And finally you come to the realization it's not anything I personally did. You can only work so many hours a day and so many days a week, and if when the return isn't there, it's just not gonna benefit you at all. And once you've dropped out, once you've quit, You'll never get back to the farm again. It's virtually impossible.
My grandfather almost lost his
farm. Terry has two sons. The eldest one is in Minneapolis, studying to be a mechanic.
There, you know, no matter how depressed I get, the final question I ask myself is, what would I like to do different? And I still can't come up with anything except I love to farm. I love to watch things grow and produce and reproduce. And that's what I hope to continue to do.
It's gone extremely downhill, tremendously. It's just turned sour.
Remember Falman Seeds, one of the largest farming operations in the county? Remember little Brian driving the giant tractor? Well, last year they took a loss of $100,000. Randall Fulman predicts trouble.
When organizations, they refer to the, if I say it right, posse comitatus, various reactionaries, right-wing individuals, anti-Jew, their feeling, and I happen to agree, that the Jewish people control much of our markets, and I've got evidence to back that up, they're listening to this right-wing faction, and they're picking up arms, they're buying semi-automatic weapons, and I'm afraid that there is going to be some violence, and my guess is that will come this winter, because it'll be much, much worse this winter.
This coming winter?
Yes.
How do you feel personally?
Am I ready to pick up arms? No. But am I ready to talk to other farmers and make a stand? Yes. The only way we can change this county tax that we're currently living under is to simply refuse to pay it. Although we as farmers are only 10% of the population, we pay half the tax. And if the farmers get together and say, I won't pay my taxes, we will stop county government, we will stop the schools from operating. And that is the only way that we can draw the attention to the problem. And basically, that's what George Washington and his cohorts did, was tax protest.
What do you think of the present administration?
I'm part of the same party, but I don't agree in his philosophy. If myself, as a seedsman, had a plan of attack and how I was going to approach the future, and the economy kept changing so that I had to change my plans with it. In other words, if I had a plan that worked, good. But if the plan didn't work, you had to change. President Reagan's attitude is, this is the way we're going to solve the problem come hell or high water. And he refused to change his approach and his plan over the past 4 or 5 years. And consequently, it takes a very stupid man not to be able to see that when he took office, the national deficit was around $300 billion, maybe $400 billion. And by the end of this year, it's $2 trillion. You know? So I happen to think that we've got a movie star president, and he can convince a lot of the people a lot of the time. If any other president would have been in office and had a left office with a national debt that was 5 times, you know, they would have crucified the man. But Reagan, for whatever reason, he can tell the world that, yes, the national deficit is 5 times higher than it ever was, but it's all right. It's all right. I don't know.
I use about a pound and a half of butter, I'll have you know. We keep the dairy farmers going here.
Tonight, we dine at Millie and Arnold Binnicky's. Millie is a great cook.
He felt they were right.
We talk and talk, gossips, Glencoe news. Clayton Hussey, the banker, just died of a heart attack. Gene Tyson has moved to Florida. I ask about their son, Brad, the Vietnam protester.
Pretty much within the system now, in the sense that he's a business person. He's did great in the sales of software, computer software, in New York and the surrounding states. And Let's put it this way, he's a little milder than he was before.
A little more subdued.
Not quite the angry young man that he was.
Now, Arnold, you're now a lawyer-actor or an actor-lawyer, or how would you define yourself?
Well, let me put it this way, I learned a lot about acting while being a lawyer.
So the company's doing well, huh?
But it seems to depend upon the show. If we have a large cast, then we fill the house. And if we have a small cast, of course, like today, that it's a small cast. But it was a pretty good house for a Sunday afternoon.
Arnold, do you feel that this town has changed considerably since we were here?
Physically, I don't think it has. There isn't any great amount of new construction except new homes. But spiritually, I think it's down. I think this depression that the farmers are in has affected the community, or infected it, whichever way it should be put. But I don't think there is the spirit here that there was 6 years ago.
Obviously, there was a lot of confidence in President Reagan, because I think the community, I know the community voted for Mr. Reagan. But after the election, I mean, we get this feeling or the signal from Washington that everything is going so well. And I don't feel that it is, because I'm judging from the food bank that we have in Glencoe. There are many more people using the food bank than before, and we're one of the most prosperous counties in Minnesota.
Financially, I think that our generation had it much better than the generation since then.
Well, I think our Brad pointed that out very well to us.
Millie and Arnold, I am proud to have become your friend. For me, you represent the best of this country. Generous, smart, dedicated, unpretentious. Great Americans.
Well, I have high hopes for this country, because things that are going on right now can only be characterized in my mind as an obsession with greed. And a nation doesn't live long with that obsession. And particularly a democracy that There's good, a lot of good in this country, a lot of good people. And they aren't gonna subscribe to this philosophy of greed that's going on now. It's horrible.